You know the bed feels warmer sleeping here alone. You know I dream in color and do the things I want. You think you got the best of me, think you've had the last laugh, but you think that everything good is gone. Think you left me broken down, think that I'll come running back. Maybe you don't know me cause you're dead wrong. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes a fighter. What steps even lighter. Doesn't mean I'm over cause you're gone. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger, stronger. Just me, myself, and I. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Afternoon, everybody. What makes you stronger? Big question today. We're going to be hearing from some amazing folks supporting students and faculty and academic institutions as we deal with this crazy pandemic and these turbulent times. My name is Mitali Chakraborty. I'm coming live from a standing desk I created in a bathroom at my mom's house in Chattanooga, Tennessee. What I would love to know is, one, how are you feeling today? Don't type yet. Two, where are you calling, dialing, videoing in from? And three, if you've been able to join a previous discussion that we've had, or this is your first one, what else would you like for us to be talking about? We've addressed internship and apprenticeship. We've talked to public policymakers. We've talked to amazing technical VPs and leaders. What else can we provide for you during these crazy times and have an open, honest discussion and provide supports and let you know Anita B. here is here to support you and make you stronger. All right, a little bit more housekeeping. Hashtag Anita B. is our hashtag for the day. Feel free to follow us at @AnitaB_ORG. We will be capturing all the suggestions that our panelists make in a document that will go out via email to you after this event. Our chat is open. We have amazing Anita B. staff in the chat that will be able to answer questions for you if they do questions and provide information in the conversation. They'll put initials. I'm sorry, I'm a little tongue-tied today. I don't know what's going on. Also, if you've got questions for our panelists, put that in the Q&A, not in the chat. So remember, questions, Q&A, chat discussion, chat. How are you feeling? Where are you from? What else would you like for us to be talking about? Okay, since I'm tongue-tied, I'm gonna give it to my much smoother coworker, our SVP of Business Development and Marketing Communications, Robert Reed.
Hey everybody, it's Robert Reed. I'm coming to you from the land of earthquakes, 90 degree weather, and pandemic. Yes, I'm in Los Angeles. I hope this finds you all very well on this Thursday. We're delighted to have you here to talk. This is our fifth in the series, as Mitali mentioned. We are going to be taking a break next week, just to let you know, but we'll be back in 2 weeks with another lineup of fantastic speakers to help us all get through this pandemic and really talk about rapid change and what it means. We invite you to visit our website, anitab.org, to make a donation or to learn more about these webinars and some of the other great activations that we have, curriculum and offerings we have as well. I'll be back at the very end to just wrap it up. But in the meantime, wanted to introduce our president and CEO, Brenda Wilkerson, who's going to invite and introduce all of our panelists. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Robert. And hello, everyone. Welcome. So glad to see you here today. Today marks week 5 in our webinar series, as you heard Robert say, and week 7 of the COVID-19 pandemic. Over the course of the past few weeks, we have focused on a wide range of topics, from the need for the private sector to maintain internships and apprenticeships in light of COVID-19, to the role that entrepreneurs, nonprofits, and small businesses will play in our recovery, to most recently, how the public and private sectors must come together to support the populations in most need. All are important topics, and all are focused on supporting our most important audience, each and every one of you in our global community. By the way, hello from Chicago, where it snowed a couple days ago, but anyway. In today's session, we are turning our attention to academia. Often the first stop in both young and not so young technologists' journeys to either be embraced into the field or encouraged to leave. Throughout my 30 plus years in the field, I have seen what it takes to successfully build a pipeline of talent and ultimately a future group of leaders that will transform how we live and how we work. Educators are critical, and not just teachers or professors, but administrators too. So whether or not students can or will develop their own personal pathways towards success, I've seen and experienced this in my own life and career. Open-minded embrace of all types of students in our educational systems is core to challenging both industry norms and what has always been. Today, I am joined by three leaders in academia to discuss the importance of building bridges and identifying ways for all students, all races, genders, backgrounds, et cetera, to break into tech. So allow me to introduce our panel today. First, we have Dr. Karen A. Stout, who is president and CEO of Achieving the Dream, the nation's largest movement to improve success for all students, especially low-income students and students of color. Dr. Stout leads, through ATD, a network of institutions who are building their capacity to enable more students to complete their education with a credential that has value. She has been recognized nationally for her achievements in ATD and at Montgomery County Community College, where she served as president for 15 years. Welcome, Karen. Next, we have Michael Ellison, who is the CEO and founder of CodePath.org. CodePath is a 501c3 nonprofit transforming computer science education for underrepresented minorities at 49 colleges and universities by improving curriculum, teaching practices, and student support. Prior to CodePath.org, Michael founded three nonprofits and three tech startups starting at age 19. Wow. Michael was also a founding board member for Women Who Code and co-founder of Segment, now one of YC's highest valued portfolio companies. Welcome, Michael. And finally, Ann Gates, Director of Computing Alliance of Hispanic-Serving Institutions. Dr. Gates is the chair of the Computer Science Department at the University of Texas, El Paso, and past Associate Vice President of Research and Sponsored Projects. She directs the NSF-funded CyberShare Center that focuses on the development of cyber infrastructure to support interdisciplinary teams. She was a founding member of the NSF Advisory Committee for Cyber Infrastructure, and she served on the Board of Governors for IEEE Computer Society from 2004 to 2009. Welcome, Anne. As you see, we've got a power-packed group of folks here today. So before we start, I want to issue a challenge, as I always do. As part of this discussion today, I want to encourage all of us to think about what we can do to address the existing gaps within computer science education and technology education. I want us to think about how we can empower students, and most importantly, how to reinvent the world's image of a technologist to look more like you and me. So let's first start with Michael. Welcome, panel. So, Michael, first of all, how are you, and how are things at CodePath.org?
Yeah, so I'm doing as well as can be expected, you know, all things considered. It's a challenging time, but I'm incredibly optimistic and energized and trying to do everything I can in the current environment. And as you know, often those who are furthest behind are also left out in a crisis like this. They're the ones who are the first ones to have their potential opportunities and hopes dashed. And we're seeing that all across the country with the students that we're working with. Students are leaving campus with oftentimes little support. They, when they're getting home and they're expected to do online courses, they may not have a strong internet connection. Many of them don't have laptops or computers to be able to be doing their assignments. Or if they do, they have to share that with family members. So we've been very much trying to think about what's everything that we can do in order to address the crisis, help students finish out the semester strong, and then also what we can do in the future. And I think we've been incredibly encouraged by so many companies and so many institutions, so many organizations like Anita B stepping up and trying to make sure we can do everything we can to support these students.
That's great. You're absolutely right. We didn't think about some of the things that were going to happen when we sent students home and expected them to continue their education. So I'm going to want to hear more about that because that's really critical. So thank you, Michael. So Karen, tell us about what's going on at your organization.
So Achieving the Dream works with about 400 community colleges across the country, and our real goal is to get more students into and through community colleges with a credential that leads to economic and social mobility. America's community colleges serve a majority of low-income students and students of color. When COVID hit, our students did not necessarily go home. They were already, pretty much at home. Some of our community colleges have dorms. But what happened with COVID, and we work with colleges to help help them redesign their supports and their programs to eliminate structural barriers to success. So when we stand everything up in a remote learning environment, what we've done is we've designed a system that creates even deeper structural barriers than the one that the students were in, or learners were in before. So what we're learning about our students is that they're vulnerable, but boy, COVID has uncovered the vulnerabilities, and they're deep and they're systemic. We knew that, but when you begin to think about food insecurity and housing insecurity, and that these are learners that are now, they're working, some of them still on the front lines, right? They're not working remotely necessarily.
Right.
They're still balancing work. They have children in the home, and now they're homeschooling, and many of them are taking care of elder parents too. So the holistic student support structure that they need now is even larger.
That's right. And when you think about front lines and essential services, all of those terms are being redefined right now, and they really do impact greatly students at community colleges. In fact, I started my first educational experience after leaving Tech in the community college system. It is an amazing space, just for the breadth of age and range of experiences of students, right, coming into Tech, and it really speaks largely to pathways into Tech versus just the narrow pipeline, right? So it's so critical.
Right. Absolutely. And generally, and we have a lot more to do as community colleges to help build that Tech pipeline. I think we're on the front lines of building that talent pool, but we can do a lot better. And we can talk more about how COVID's influencing that as we go through the conversation.
Yeah. But great work. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Okay. Anne, talk to us about what's going on in your organization.
Sure. Our organization has a lot of similarities to Karen's. We are serving the Hispanic community. We also involve community colleges. This is something new. CAHSI was founded in 2004, and then we received funding in 2018 through the NSF Includes Alliance Program, one of eight across the country. So the focus is really on inclusion, equity, and advancing innovation and discovery. When we are looking at the challenges that we're facing right now, a lot of them are centered on what Michael and what Karen have already discussed. Faculty had to very quickly, within 2 weeks, go online. Many of them did not have that experience before, so it was a very rapid turnover or turning over from going in person to online, and then worrying about the students' availability to the technology and bandwidth. Right. And so there was a lot of efforts across all of our institutions to ensure that our students were not lost in this transition. Just as Karen said, I mean, one of the big challenges that we were really trying to look at is how do we have the coverage of the topics and the quality of education that students should have, because we're really focused. Our vision is that by 2030, we'll have 20% representation of Hispanics in computing, and we want our students to be highly competitive. So we don't want to lose that momentum of having that quality education. And we also want to make sure that we're looking at their well-being, the financial needs, food insecurity, and family care needs that Karen mentioned as well. Just to give you an idea, at UTEP, nearly 75% of our students receive financial aid. More than 50 are from the lowest income quartile, and one third have family incomes of less than 20,000. So you can understand a lot of the challenges. But CAHSI has come together. We can talk a little bit later about some of the things we're doing. But really trying to be a resource for our students so that they are successful during this period.
That's right. And we've heard now twice about food insecurities, and I want to bring that up because I think a lot of times people don't think about that as part of the challenges that students have in being able to go to college and complete college. And we've been working to try to step into that gap at AnitaV.org. And it's a huge gap, right? So I just really want to put that out there that there is a huge need. Many times people are not able to continue on because they can't pay their rent, they can't fix their car, they don't have food to eat. And it's just a challenge and something that I feel like we can fix, but we first have to address it. So thank you guys for bringing that up.
Yeah, and I was going to say along that line is that one of the things that CAHSI is doing is that we ask each of our institutions, and we work with over 40 institutions, 60 if you start talking about nonprofits and industry partners. But one of the things that we ask them to do is to create these one pagers where they talk about, you know, where's your food pantry? Where can you go to get that? What are the resources at the institution? But try to consolidate that so that they have access to that. And then we are putting it on our website. We're adding national resources so that they have access to that. And I think it's really important that they are able to find the information that they need in order to be able to address this very challenging time for them.
Yeah, indeed critical, right? Absolutely, absolutely. So Michael, talk to me about some of the challenges that you feel, you talked to me about some of them that you see with students right now with COVID. What do you foresee happening, especially for students of color mm-hmm. in the next few months? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so and we're seeing challenges with multiple partners and stakeholders, students. We serve institutions as well. We also serve major technology companies and employers. And so from the student standpoint, we really have one topic top of mind right now, which is these are the lost summer work opportunities, the lost technical work opportunities. 25% of our students that we've served in the past year have canceled internships right now. And so what we've been trying to do, there's a couple things on the policy side with some of our partners. We've been trying to influence some of this legislation to allow students to be able to have work study as something that they'll be able to receive for learning opportunities over the course of the summer. We're also very much focused on what we can do to provide paid learning opportunities over the summer for our students, focused on need. And that goes for us trying to actually replace this lost work opportunity. Yeah. And then I would say lastly, you know, institutions, it has been very important for us to try to support professors and as they make that transition that was mentioned earlier. And we helped around 26 colleges and universities, retrained our student leaders on campuses and to help those universities to be able to transition to online in the first couple of weeks of the pandemic. So we're kind of seeing it from multiple sides, but I think there's a huge opportunity at this moment to help to improve and support institutions. When you think of an online course, an online classroom, there's opportunities for engagement and interactivity that you might not normally have, and that you can think around at scale, leveraging tools. And I think there's an opportunity for us to make it feel normal for students to have paid learning opportunities that are an entry point into paid work opportunities at scale.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. A lot of room for innovation around solving this problem right now. And I just want to, you know, thank you guys for being on the front line of addressing these types of issues for both the student and the educators in general. So Karen, can you also speak to that? What do you see the academic challenges in the classroom being, particularly for students of color, for lower income students at this time?
Well, I think our colleges are focused on what I'll call learning continuity. Just making sure that students were able to make the transition from face-to-face to the remote environment and dealing with what I call COVID melt. How many of those students were able to make the transition? How many have signed into the LMS, the learning management system? How can we trace their access to financial aid supports, transitioning food pantry supports, getting laptop computers in the hands of students, understanding broadband access issues, affordability issues with that. And then on top of that, institutions are supporting faculty who have also, and sometimes we forget about this, been thrust into a similar environment. They are also now teaching from home and adjusting to remote learning, balancing children at home, family obligations, and institutions don't really have a strong infrastructure to support faculty at 100% scale teaching online. So that's been a rapid kind of change for the faculty. So you put those two things together. And what we're learning as our colleges are reporting data on, we call the term data through disruptions. So we're asking them to let us know what's happening. The students that are most likely not transitioning with continuity are students of color and students, low-income students, and the proxy for that are students that are on Pell Grants, but we also know that many of our students, even not on Pell Grants, are fundamentally low-income, low-resource students. So I'd say that's where we're really trying to focus our energy right now. Colleges are being very flexible in how they structure semesters, how they're doing grading, extending lab experiences for STEM and computer kind of courses that are hard to transition into a remote environment at times,
right,
into the summer or into the fall, and being as flexible and empathetic as we possibly can be.
So critical. And yes, you mentioned the just stark transition for educators into all of a sudden now your classroom is online. And the challenges that go with that. So, and a lot of learnings to come from that too. So really grateful for that hard work. So, Anne, I want to hear from you a little bit on what some of the strategies are your partners are using to further your mission. You're looking to, you know, you're focused, your organization is focused on the low representation of Hispanics in computing in both higher education and the workforce. So what types of strategies do you see coming forward right now to make sure that stays on track?
Yeah, so just to give you a little bit of a background, we use a collective impact model. And so when we look at strategic planning, we look at it from an institutional level, a regional level, and then the national level. So from a national perspective, one of the strategies we're trying to address right now is what Michael brought up, and that is the loss of opportunities for the summer and internships. So there's a lot of thoughts we have in that area, but one thing that we're really focused on right now strategically is to identify how we can provide our students with research on undergraduate research opportunities. So, and we're looking for the funding to be able to support the students through the summer. Keep them engaged. I mean, one of our biggest strategies right now and what we're worried about is the engagement of students. So this whole idea of isolation, you know, at first it's fine. As it moves on, it becomes even more of a challenge. And so how can we continue to engage our students? So we're looking at doing more virtual professional development, If you look at what California State Dominguez Hills has done, they have created virtual hackathons that they have been running for 2 years already. And so now is a great opportunity to continue that, those hackathons that get the students engaged and keep them motivated across the institutions. They need that that person-to-person touch. So we have what we call CAHSI advocates, and we have CAHSI scholars. These are student scholars at each of the institutions. And their role is to connect with the students, to disseminate what resources are out there, get them on the CAHSI support group. They also serve as a voice for the leadership at each institution, learning from what they're hearing the students are saying, what challenges that they need. So those are some of the things that we're doing. We're also launching a survey next week so that we could have a better understanding of how this shift from virtual learning has affected the students and their interests, but also their feelings toward degree persistence. Because this is something we really need to be thinking about moving forward and not waiting later on to find out that we're losing the students in our degree.
That's right. And that's something that we're not going to necessarily understand for a while, and getting in front of it, right, is going to be really important. Right. Yeah, that's great. So I just kind of want to throw this out to everyone. And we've already kind of been discussing this, but what is the discussion going on in each of your circles about how to, and I know this is something that you do as a matter of course, is address inequity, right, in the classroom. Mm-hmm. That's what's so important about each and every one of your work. What is the discussion like now? And how does this support the larger movement for education equality over time?
I'll jump in first. Maybe, you know, we've been at Achieving the Dream working a lot on reframing our work around teaching and learning. We've done a lot of institutional redesign and transformation on the edges around student affairs and the way services are provided to students, looking at equity gaps and hoping that by transforming the way students access into our community colleges and they use the supports, financial aid, tutoring, you know, those wraparound things, that we would begin to see improvement in the equity gaps. There's a little bit with that, but it's not scaled and it's not enough. Mm-hmm. So we've started to move into the classroom knowing that every faculty member touches every student. They are our scalers. So getting faculty involved and professional development, looking at their data, all types of work with the faculty. Now, COVID has really made that an imperative. It really made it an imperative. So, there's already structural inequities in classrooms that we help faculty with cultural responsive teaching kind of practices face-to-face. Now transitioning those into a remote learning environment on a dime is very challenging. We already know the data on online learning and inequity. It's greater. For community colleges, it's much greater. You just think about the tools that students need in order to do the online learning. So we've had a series of 4 webinars over the last month, and we've had as many as 1,000 faculty members from community colleges across the country, whether they're in our network or not, learning with us about strategies to break down the walls and barriers. And we're learning, some students that face-to-face was not working well for are actually thriving in the online learning environment.
Right.
Others are not. And we worry that we're amplifying the inequities that are already in the system with this. So what the redesign looks like going forward, when Brenda, you called it the next normal, this is going to be at the heart of the work of Achieving the Dream on institutional transformation.
That's awesome.
Yeah, one of the things that I think that we really need to look at are the institutional policies regarding access to technology and appropriate broad bandwidth. Depending on what major you're on, if that's going to you know, we need to understand what is required to be successful in that major. And I'm afraid, and I don't know this, but I'm afraid that there are not that many institutions that are really looking after the students when they're coming in and ensuring that they have what it needs to succeed in the major. So it's like it used to be textbooks, everything's online now. And this is, we're going to see hybrid teaching and learning moving forward. I don't think it's ever going to go completely back to face-to-face. I mean, that we're going to have hybrid models, and I think it's probably a good thing. What I've seen at UTEP, and I can speak to that because that's where I've had more immediate access, what I've seen faculty do is really come together to support each other, to share best practices. They're even talking about, you know, having observations, and so that they can help look at, you know, how are you presenting the information? How are you providing access to resources online? One professor, I'll just say really quickly, said, I give extra credit points to students that come in and tell me what's not working. And I think that, you know, kind of getting that immediate feedback, because it's so different. And I hopefully Michael can speak more about this. It's so different when you go to virtual learning. And so, and we're doing it on the fly. And so we really need to come together as a community, especially in computer science, where I think it's very different because of the labs that we have and project-based learning and all of that stuff that we integrate into the class.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, so
Michael.
Thanks. Thank you. We're kind of thinking and talking about daily, weekly, two major issues. One is the activation of underrepresented minority students into pursuing computer science, software engineering. Two is the persistence. And we've been running, I mean, we partner with colleges, universities to provide a back end for their existing computer science courses, but we also have been running for years online only courses that we use to reach across schools. So one course that just completed was running during this spring, had 149 students. It was across 50 different colleges and universities, 37% first-generation college students, 49% Black, 48% female, 33% had a family income under $30,000 a year. And the net promoter score, which is a measure of satisfaction virality between negative 100 to positive 100, for that course was 79. To put that in perspective, the iPhone has a net promoter score of 72. The AirPods, Apple AirPods, have a net promoter score of 75. So we view courses like this, there's an opportunity to activate, to inspire, to make students fall in love with programming. So we are talking about that on a daily, weekly basis. We're thinking about what are the feeder programs, what are the programs you take before a lot of traditional CS courses to make you just love the idea of becoming a programmer that also expose you to industry. And so one of the big things we're talking about as well related to that is the capacity building. How can we add an additional 1,000 students to be enrolled in this program in the fall, which would be roughly a doubling above and beyond the existing program size. The second piece when we're thinking about persistence, so for a lot of students in CS, they start majoring without having any idea of what the industry looks like. They haven't met, especially from underrepresented backgrounds, software engineers. They don't have the mentorship. They don't see people that look like them. They have definitely not connected with people who look like them who are in these various career paths. Software engineering is very broad. There's so many different ways that you can become inspired, that you can find your passion. And so we think of the work opportunities and the mentorship with professional engineers as a critical component of this. We're currently, some of you know that we run Facebook University, which is their program for underrepresented minority students to first get an exposure freshman or sophomore year to programming. Facebook announced on Monday that they're going virtual. So it means that this summer we'll be running virtual internship programs. And we would like to, while running this experience, help to share that with the community, because the idea of these early career, early entry points into tech that are scalable, that your geography doesn't matter, you can participate from anywhere. That I think there's an opportunity there to integrate that with the great work colleges and universities are already doing, so that there's a more seamless educate, work, and get paid, and have upward mobility and employment, which we think is a very important piece of persistence over the undergraduate experience.
It's so true. I mean, there's that opportunity again out of all of this, out of this crisis, right, to take geography out of the question. You know, so many times mm-hmm. it's where you live that had something to do with where you got to go to school and where you live based upon your ability to go to work for some of these companies. And now with this crisis, we're having to rethink boundaries, some in a very negative way, but in some in a very positive way. And you've just given a really great example of how we can start to break down some barriers here. But you also said something that I want to segue to, and I'm going to start with you in this because you brought it up. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to the importance of students having role models in mm-hmm. their future field of interest that look like them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And
How critical is that?
Oh my gosh. I don't know if it was among these panelists, but there's an idea. I think it's very powerful. It's very true. Very easy to remember. You can't be what you can't see. And you can't be inspired. Like, you can't fall in love with an area that you have no knowledge of. You can't relate to that. And I think, you know, as educators, the first step, your first success or failure is, can you connect with the students? And it's no different online or in person. You still need to build that connection. You need to meet them emotionally where they are. And I think that the best way, the most effective way we've been able to find of how to do that is very early in many of our courses, we have a panel. It's engineers that look like them. They're coming from similar backgrounds. They're sharing their stories. And that makes something, a career pathway that might have seemed impossible becomes possible. You can envision it. You can see yourself in it. So Brenda, I can't emphasize how important that is, because there's a missing connection point, especially we're talking about underrepresented populations. And also we're looking at schools where the enrollment in the CS program, just generally speaking, is not as high as it should be or could be. And there's this missing connection piece. You may be taking, you know, a calculus course, but that's not giving you the connection to what this could look like as a career that you could really love.
That's so critical.
If I could build on that, I mean, there's two pieces of this. Something Michael said earlier caught my attention, and this is around understanding the career that you're trying to enter. And our colleges put career planning and advising on the back end of the student experience rather than on the very front end. So helping community colleges to redesign the way that those supports are offered is essential. And when we're working with our colleges, we are helping them to understand their own demographic data around the composition of their faculty, full-time faculty, part-time faculty, and then by program. And then also to look at the student profiles within all of those programs and to see if there are clear gaps across the country, especially in the area of computing. So colleges they have to redesign their sourcing, their hiring, their connections with business and industry, you know, what they think about the skill sets required for faculty in these program areas. Yep. And it takes a while to get there. So while they are getting there, I see a lot of colleges engaging, growing their own, especially community colleges, engaging successful either students at the end of their community college career as peer mentors and matching with students, or building their future faculty pipeline from students right. who are successful. So they're getting very creative with meeting the challenge.
That's awesome.
Yeah, when we, this really speaks to the work of possible selves, and it goes back to Michael's quote, right? Do I see this as a possible self for me? And what's really important is that we share the stories of who we are, how we got there, because all of us have our stories of being first in the family or having parents that couldn't really afford to pay for the tuition. You had to work in order to go through. So we really focus on sharing those stories. We have the CAHSI advocates, and we have what we call CAHSI scholars, and we are recognizing those students that go above and beyond within the classroom. They're going into professional development workshops, they're seeking out the internships and all of these other opportunities to build their technical knowledge, but they're also reaching out to the community. And what we are seeing them is as the future leaders. Because for us to grow, we need to, all of our graduates need to come out really understanding that there's a deep need for diversifying computer science, the role that they play to be able to do that. And so whether they're going into industry or going to graduate school, they are starting to really own the mission of CAHSI and our vision. And so we really focus on our students working with the other students at each of the institutions. So as an HSI at UTEP, we're 80% Hispanic. It's really the females that we really have to really pay a lot of attention to. Grace Hopper, when students go to Grace Hopper and they come back and say, oh my God, I've never seen so many females, that has a huge impact on them. Yeah. We also work with Great Minds in STEM, and the students also have that same feeling of being able to see people that look like themselves, and that really motivates them to have those personal contacts.
It really does. And I can say in my own life, I have seen students and folks coming into tech who, when they tell their stories, and they are not necessarily the traditional stories, you know, I went right from here to mm-hmm. there to there. It inspires so many people who have just sort of like this notion that I can't be it because, and fill mm-hmm. in the blank, right? And they don't understand that we've all come to technology from a variety of backgrounds, because that's not what the narrative says, right? And right. that's not the picture of the narrative. So it's really important for us to start changing that picture and changing those stories. And so we have to share. Everybody out there, please share your story. Mm. So this is a great discussion. So I just want to kind of shift this a bit and ask you, you know, there's a lot of work to be done. You guys are on the front lines. You're working hard in what was already important, and now it's doubly important so that we don't lose all of the momentum that we had going, right? All the progress that we were making, getting diversity into tech. So how can the private and public sectors support you today? What kinds of things could they do to help?
Well, our community colleges are only as strong, and this is a broader macro kind of answer, and Anne and Michael can go deeper. Our community colleges are really, you know, only as strong as the organizational capacity pieces of our structures. When we've been underfunded for an under-resourced for so long. So we need to, as community colleges, begin to look at building private sector investment opportunities, foundation support, and much stronger employer ties that are not transactional, but are very deep and are woven into the student experience, no matter whether it's a computer science degree program or any type of industry-facing program. So, you know, we need our partners to begin to, first of all, recognize community colleges are on the front lines of this work, and that more than 50% of America's undergraduates are, you know, starting off at America's community colleges. That's right. And more than 50% of baccalaureate degree holders have community college credit in their portfolio, right? So that we are those local, you know, local pipeline builders. And then, you know, those that have invested in us in these times with COVID, stay with us. And if you have not invested with us, connect with your local community college and try to form a partnership. We need your support now, you know, now more than ever with the students that we're losing, and what happens to a local community when there is not a pipeline of qualified graduates to support the local community.
So I have three recommendations for companies. So companies, I mean, they know what the skills they need are, right? They have different job descriptions, and training providers and educational institutions try to figure out constantly, okay, what do you actually mean by X? And I think companies can do a much, much better job of demonstrating that there's alignment when they say this is a role, like this is a whatever type of developer, engineer, whatnot, then there's actually alignment across companies. There also can be a much greater alignment and communication directly to schools. Karen, thanks for sharing about community colleges, because they are so important to our communities. If we forget about those, we're throwing everything out. And employers, there's an opportunity for them to provide enough alignment, I think, where it can go beyond credential. The someone completing a course I'm a broken record here, it's a direct path to employment, which from an employer standpoint should be a dream, right? They took the course, they got a grade. Oh, I want to hire everybody that got that grade, right? There is an opportunity there to create a lot more alignment, but I think industry needs to lead, and industry also needs to be investing in these institutions, many of which are under-resourced to begin with. And then a second piece is early career. So early career, I'm talking about job opportunities that are actually entry level, whether it's apprenticeship programs, whether it's before an internship program. Usually when employers, especially in tech, are talking about these entry level positions, they're not entry level. They require previous experience, skills, the technical challenges that you have to jump through in order to be able to pass that can be kind of insane, right? So we need authentically, not say a few more, we need thousands more of these early career opportunities where I'm learning and I'm being mentored and I can figure that out. So employers need to do that. It needs to be directly integrated and in partnership with these institutions that are developing this talent. And then lastly, I think there is also, on top of this point, there's an opportunity to move beyond let me frame it from a kind of an example. So students that we're teaching at certain schools, could be Cal State Monterey Bay, could be Merritt College, have to apply to hundreds of times the number of companies to hear back. And it will be something like a student over at San Jose State University has to apply to 800 companies and hears back from, say, a dozen. And a student over at Purdue will apply to 10 and hears back from all the companies. And this isn't based on skills. This isn't based on quality. We're running the same course, graded the same way at both of these sites. And we see this massive disparity where students are just not given an opportunity. So employers need to be not just willing, but they need to be proactively and aggressively taking steps to make sure that they are authentically giving people an opportunity to even step up. And I'm sick of hearing from students that we work with, oh, Black students don't get internships in undergrad. You know, where'd you hear that? Oh, you know, all my friends that are in CS, like we just, you know, we apply and then we don't hear back. And so we just don't expect that to happen. So there's an opportunity for companies to step up across each of those different levels. Yeah.
Well put, well said.
Anne? Yeah, I'd like to address it from a little bit different perspective, but also to build on what you just said. We work with Google on a number of initiatives, but one that was really a big game changer was a Google CAHSI partnership to create problem solving courses. One credit, two credit, and one two credit hour course, starting with freshmen, because we wanted the freshmen to have the skills to be successful. This has led at UTEP to almost tripling the number of internships that are being offered, not just by Google, but other companies. And they have come back and said, what is the difference? Well, it's really the way this is a very much, it's based on problems. Students are working on teams. It's not around lecture. It's around reflection. It's really around cognition and really an amazing class that we're disseminating that. I'd also like to talk about the importance of partnerships in the K through 12. And I think that we CAHSI has identified a number of partnerships to start educating or helping teachers to become certified in computer science. And I think this is really going to be important for us to really have the type of courses that we need in high schools and the excitement for students then to go on into the degree, that early preparation. So we really, we're working right now on a Microsoft CS Teacher Academy that is not just helping them become certified, because the exam is very superficial in my opinion, but they need the depth of understanding of what it means to be computer scientists. And it's not coding, it's not just coding, it's right. More than that, right? Wow. And so that's one of the things that we're really focused on. The other thing I'd like to say is that really concerned about the internships, where we realize is so important. I know that AnitaB.org and others have addressed that. I think that that's crucial. But I'd like to talk to those industry partners that are not able to have the internships. And I'd like them to think about taking the opportunity to do webinars, whether it's talking about some new technology or even doing a virtual tour of their organization, helping the students to kind of see what it's like, a day in the life. You know, what do you do? Who are the people there? How, you know, what are the types of projects you're working on? I think that that could really make a difference. And then I want to promote the an idea of having externships where faculty are working with the industry partners on projects, and now they can mentor much larger number of students. Our students, we've said this already, many of them, because of family obligations, cannot just get up and go to summer internships, even without COVID-19, right? I mean, it's not a possibility because of family obligations, maybe taking care of elderly parents. So I'd like to take the opportunity where we're at now to start, you know, appealing to this ability to provide the experience on campus. I know it doesn't replace the experience of being at the company itself, but I think that there are ways that we could think creatively to create that experience for our students that can't afford to go out of town.
Yeah, thank you. The time is now to be creative. I think that is the word for today. So this is amazing. We could go on forever. I want to give the folks that are online an opportunity to ask some questions. So Charlie, take it away.
Yes, this has been amazing, everybody. And I just want to preface, we're probably only going to get to a couple questions, but to the audience, if you did submit a question to the Q&A, we'll try to respond to it via email post this event, just because there are very specific questions for this audience. And I've noticed that the number stayed the same throughout. So thank you, everybody, for all of your tips, suggestions. But one of the things that came in a couple times is really addressing mental health during this time. We actually had somebody write in from New Orleans and saying a lot of these students that are currently in school, in college or community colleges, they experience Katrina. Any thoughts on supports that they can get for the mental issues that they're facing right now?
That's a great question. And mm-hmm. Even in the best of times, community colleges were not doing the best scaled work around mental health supports. We rely on strong partnerships with our community and our community partners and help students with referrals. But I'll say that right now, I know most of my community college colleagues have asked the faculty to do almost daily check-ins with their students. Just to keep track and help them. So that's one like quick thing that I know our community colleges are working on now.
Yeah, and it's something that we know is huge. And I agree with Karen. We are seeing that the faculty are reaching out individually. They're watching who's coming online and who's not coming online. And it's not just the faculty, it's our staff, at least at UTEP, that are doing that. I think that it's really important that we provide resources so that students know where to go. CAHSI has started a support group on Facebook through our CAHSI Facebook page. And that's where we're encouraging students to share information and to also reach out so that we can identify the appropriate resources to help them through this.
So the community that we're talking about, mental health is a concern always, and the pandemic has, of course, it's an additional layer. But I think that well-designed online courses have the potential to be very emotionally supportive for students. And the idea to think of what's a good online course, well, what's a good small learning environment? What if we were trying to approximate tutoring or mentoring or an emotionally very supportive relationship, what would we do? And how would you leverage, if you're using Zoom, how would you leverage breakout sessions? How would you leverage your existing PAs to help to provide a small group environment in addition to a lecture after the course? What channels are you providing? There's a lot of tools that are great. We actually use Slack, and we have all of our students across the country on Slack. And then we have a number of moderators who are supposed to follow up with students on a regular basis. And so I think these tools do provide opportunities if you can be thoughtful. And it's okay to not get it right the first time because, of course, you can iterate and students are going to pretty quickly understand what's going on.
Thank you for that. Also, two or three questions around mentorship. People are saying that I thought I would get a mentor for my summer internship. My summer internship was canceled. I thought my faculty advisor would be my mentor, but I haven't cultivated that relationship. Step one, during these pandemic times, can people look for mentors? And what do you do? How did you do it? How did you connect with your mentors? I know that I've used cold emails via LinkedIn, but that's not always the solution. Would just love some feedback for folks on how to cultivate that relationship to find a mentor.
Pandemic or not pandemic, I think being brave enough to step up and ask questions and the cold calling, it does work in some cases. So I think sometimes our students are hesitant to approach a faculty member and start a conversation. And I just would encourage, even in this remote environment, in fact, I think there's probably more likelihood that there will be a response in the remote environment because it is so intimate, as Michael said, that students should start experimenting with that and with their faculty members. That's always their program faculty member, their discipline faculty member can be a very strong mentor and guide, especially in helping with internships and externships.
So I was going to say that many of you may be familiar with MentorNet. Great Minds in STEM now has picked that up. And so we worked with them some time ago, and we had a whole series of questions trying to understand the background of the student. You know, are you first in your family? Are you community college transfer? I mean, what is your background and what's your interest in mentoring? And so you might look at Great Minds in STEM, GMIS, and see look at the possibility of online mentoring.
One of the most valuable things that I've done throughout my career has been focusing on thinking of mentors as friendships, thinking of it as building my network is, I have a goal, there's shared connection, interests, and being somewhat fearless about just reaching out to see if there is a connection. Mm-hmm. So having a goal of there's a place I want to go, you'd be surprised how many people just want to help you out. You'd be surprised about the response rate if you just send an email from your campus email address and then you email a random engineer at some company. Lots of people really, really want to help. There's many more people with so many corporate volunteering initiatives being canceled. There's many more people who are interested in helping in their area of expertise than there are opportunities available or easy for them to be able to find. So I highly encourage you to reach out, have a goal for your own development that you can share with this person, and think about it in terms of building friendships over the long term.
Amazing. I'm going to wrap up with one last question. I'm also just around mentorship. We had a couple of board members from community colleges that had asked, what can I do when my employer is not hiring? Just wanted to say, I think the answers to the last question is what you could do. See how you could become a mentor this summer if you're not hiring and if you want to give back to the students at your school. So that's one. But we like to end on a little bit of a high note. And so there's been some great solutions and projects and programs popping up during this pandemic, and hopefully a lot of them stay in place post-pandemic, but would love to hear from each one of you, you know, share a success story of a partnership or connection that you've heard over the past month and a half that might really give folks some hope and inspire them to keep trucking. So let's start with Karen, go to Anne, Michael, and then we'll end with Brenda. Thank you.
I'm going to just share two stories that are about motivation and passion and commitment. One is student story, one is faculty story. This student story shows you, I think, the grit and persistence of the students at community colleges. This is not a computer science major, but it is. This young man is an emergency medical major, and he was responding to his online course from a tent, doing his Zoom while he was working and in his, in his PPE. And he did not want to let his instructor down. So I think that just shows you a little bit about the grit of students. And then a faculty member, the grit of faculty in this time, and we rely so heavily on them and we celebrate them. This is an adjunct faculty member who teaches English 101, or actually it's a remedial English class, and she does not have broadband access in at her home. So she gets in her RV in the morning and drives 11 miles to the local public library and with her two children in the RV, and they all get access to the internet. She's able to teach, and her children are able to learn. Amazing stories, and those are inspirational, and I think that's what will keep us moving forward.
Yeah, I'll share a story of one of our students that talked about getting together with his twin brother, who's a mechanical engineer, and with another student who's a chemist, and they're looking at developing prototypes for low-cost filtration masks. And I thought that I was just really impressed with this idea of really wanting to give back to the community. We're on the border. Mexico is right across the way, and they're facing a shortage of masks right now. The other thing I'm going to share with you is something that we've learned. You know, while we talk a lot about going virtual and the problems, challenges that faces, one thing that we have learned is that we have started virtual office hours, we have started virtual study sessions, and virtual advising. And what we have found is that it's really doable and it's really highly effective. And it is reaching a particular demographic that we have not really been paying much attention to, I would say. It's those students that are working, they come to campus and they leave because they have to work, they have to take care of family. And so now we have heard anecdotally, students have come back and said, this has really helped me to be able to talk to a faculty member online. I don't know why we weren't doing it before, but I think that we're learning a lot of things of what we can do to reach and broaden our impact for student success.
So our on our end, student leaders are heroes. And they've done so much over the past couple months, it's hard to pick just one thing, but I'll share that earlier in the semester, we had one of our student leaders created a Slack chat bot, and we wanted to figure out how could we provide micro earning opportunities for students, and how could we also address student support. And so this Slack bot, when a student has a question, then any student across the any of our schools can answer this question. They actually get paid if they answer it within a certain amount of time. That's made it so that now across all of our campuses, we average, you have a question on homework or anything, it's answered within 30 minutes. And this has been incredibly valuable and impactful during this pandemic, but it also shows these interesting, innovative opportunities. And we didn't think of it. It was, you know, one of our students who was just empowered as a student leader who ended up putting this together. I have countless more examples, but I'm just continually inspired by what young people can achieve when you just give them an opportunity to do so.
And it's been wonderful, and we're out of time. I'm just going to end with innovation happens in the hardest times. And what we're seeing is that people are rising to the challenge, addressing each other's needs, and I'm really encouraged by it. And it doesn't matter how old you are, how young you are, how abled you are, all of those barriers come tumbling down. They never really were real barriers. People made them barriers, and now that we are all in the same boat, people are rising to challenges and really getting opportunity to show their grit. So I'm really grateful for that. And I'm really grateful that all of you, for all of the wealth of knowledge that you shared with us today, for all the hard work that you're doing. Thank you so much for it. Thank you, everyone who's attended. It's so great to have all your questions in chat. And I'm going to turn it back over to Robert.
Perfect. Thanks, Brenda. And thanks all to the panelists for such an informative session, really inspirational. And as Brenda said, we're going to get you a lot of those folks that are on the phone. We're going to get you a lot of the information because so much has come through the chat. I don't think we were all able to keep up with it. So really appreciate your time. If we could throw up that last slide, Brenda, just some other ways to get engaged with the need to be. I'm sorry, Deidre, if you could throw up that last slide. Just a couple ways to get engaged. Obviously, aneetab.org. You know, any donation in a text to give, you'll see the number there. Join our community. I know Deidre put it in our in the channel as well, in the chat. Really a great opportunity to talk with others that are in your situation or about mentorship or anything that we talked about today. And also we have a Tech Journey Scholarship for those that are really, as we talked about today, for those that are really impaired by whether it's technology, whether it's childcare, whatever it is, there's a Tech Journey Scholarship that we have developed. go to anitab.org to find out more information about that. Again, many thanks to everyone. Stay safe, and we'll be back in 2 weeks with another leadership seminar. Take care. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.